Vanderlande, moving your business forward.
Welcome to Our Robots, Our Friends. This is the title of the first edition of Vanderlande Connects, a series of webinars dedicated to discussing the latest challenges and solutions in the world of state-of-the-art logistics process automation in warehousing. My name is Mike Cooper, and I'm your moderator for the series, which comes to you live from the Vanderlande studios in Veghel in the south of the Netherlands. First of all, we at Vanderlande sincerely hope that you and your families are managing to cope with the difficult times that we all meet the challenges of the COVID-19 pandemic. Today, we're working under the most strict safety conditions. I've got a few practical matters to run by you first before I introduce today's guests. So, first of all, please feel free to ask questions at any time during the webinar. You can fill it in the questions in the GoToWebinar platform. Simply type in your question where it says, enter a question for staff. We've got quite a few people in today, so we may not be able to answer all your questions live in the studio, but don't worry because your questions will be looked after by a team of people behind the scenes. So any questions are welcome. We're going to do our best to answer them. Even if we don't get to them, we will fix them afterwards. Also, during the presentation, some people experience a bit of jumping of the screen because of the videos that we play. Don't worry, it's part of the system. Just stay with us in the GoToWebinar arena and it will work out. So no worries there. Just stay with us. Right, I'd like to introduce our first guest, Floris Scher. Floris Scher is Market Director Food and Manager of the Robotics Group at Vanderlande Industries here in Veghel. His main focus is working together with Vanderlande customers to manage and apply the best solution strategy and levels of automation, including robotics, which is why we're here, for their specific needs. He's an expert in business process improvement and logistics supply chain management. He returned from Canada last year, where he was Vanderlande's regional director, and brings to this table his extensive experience running process automation projects and services in a wide range of industrial sectors. He has a Master of Science degree in aerospace engineering from the Technical University in Delft. Welcome, Floris, glad you could be here. I'll pass the stage over to you.
Thank you, Mike, and thank you everybody for joining in our webinar today. Personally, very excited to be here. Remote's working as well. Very excited to be here, and of course, really excited to see what Maarten has in store for us today. But before we do, what I'll do today is take you through a brief introduction of, firstly, Vanderlande itself, so give you the latest on where the company stands and what we're up to. Secondly, a brief overview of the key market dynamics that we see. And thirdly, the technology. So, of course, in the end, we'll also zoom in on what the key question of today's webinar means for us. Firstly, on the company itself, about Vanderlande, the company profile. So, market leader, established in 1949, 6,500 employees. And about those employees, we like to say we think globally but act locally. And what we mean with that is that as an organization, we're spread over 28 offices around the world and deliver projects in actually over 100 countries around the world as well. 1.6 billion revenue annually spread over three key segments, airports, warehousing and parcel, delivering innovative systems with intelligent software and lifecycle services. This series of webinars focuses on the middle segment of warehousing. At the bottom of the slide here, you can see that we're part of Toyota Industries Corporation, who acquired Vanderlande in 2017. And I'll say a few more things about that as well. It is actually a very successful mix in the sense of compatibility, firstly, of the remote guys, not working, of compatibility between our products. So in this overview, what you see is the size of the units on the horizontal axis and the level of automation on the vertical axis. And what we've plotted here very generically is roughly in which areas we as Vanderlande are active and in which areas Toyota material handling is active. So as you can see here, it's not hard to imagine that within projects or within supply chains, we can work together with Toyota to serve our customers for different needs. The other thing about this combination as well is that we are able to join forces among other in the area of development of AV solutions. Also the fact that Toyota is a product company and Vanderlande a project company makes it, in terms of capacities, a very strong mix. Next slide, please. A bit on our customers within warehousing. This is a cross-section of some of the customers that we work with. We have three main focus areas, the food industry, general merchandise, and fashion. But rather than me explaining to you what our customers think about us, let me play this short video to you with interviews of a couple of our key stakeholders at our customers, explaining to you how they think and feel about us as a company.
I think the important thing that we all recognise is that between Asda and Vanderlande, it's a partnership.
Being able to take into account our individual needs during the project planning.
Our partnership with Vanderlande has brought their experience and knowledge from other projects to Urban Outfitters to advise us on what they think is the best way to grow our e-commerce.
We've definitely seen an improvement through having the automated system.
We now deliver twice the volume in half the space. Our cost per case is significantly improved versus the old solution. The Vanderlande solution is ergonomically sound for an aging workforce, and a lot safer in what it delivers.
Realmente nuestro socio de confianza, en el cual nos sentimos seguros y bien atendidos en toda la vida útil de la instalación.
Our relationship with Vanderlande has been a strong partnership with our on-site support staff. We've had several bumps and bruises through the go live. We're feeling like it's all ironed out and ready to run.
We have a long-lasting relationship with Vanderlande, and we appreciate the excellence of project management, the wide range of products, and the level of innovation they bring.
Vanderlande, moving your business forward.
So what I particularly want to point out in this video is the number of times that customers, when they refer to Vanderlande, talk about things like partnership and relationship. Of course, we're a technology company, but as we like to say, in a world of technology, of believe in people, it's all about relationships. And in order to successfully apply these technologies, relationships and partnerships are key for us. This webinar is no exception of us putting effort in actually creating those relationships and connections with yourselves. Then a bit on the market dynamics. So if you look at this slide, what we're seeing in terms of the dynamic landscape we are all in the middle rectangle, you see the key social and business trends that we identify as a company that impact our solutions most. To name a few, in the bottom right here, you can see online growth. Of course, all of you have seen what the pandemic has done with people switching from traditional shopping to online shopping. Also things like order lead time and expectations there with instant delivery, for example, are hugely impactful to our solutions. Then if you switch to the outside triangle, you see the technology trends that we've identified as the ones that impact us and our solutions most. So on the right top, for example, you see big data, artificial intelligence, and sensor and automation, to name a few. And of course, for today's topic, robots, hugely important for us as well. Which brings us to technology. If you look at this recent poll done by MHI last year, you can see the answers of key stakeholders in the industry to the questions of what they will think has the potential to disrupt, which technologies have the potential to disrupt the market. And what you see is here that also robotics and automation is listed as a top priority for a lot of them. Now, what that means for us is next I will show you a video with smart item robotics, which is a video that shows you a solution that is currently in development. Secondly, what you're seeing right now is automated palletizing, which is a solution that we have installed at different sites. So these are just two examples of focus applications, as we like to call them, within robotics. But rather than us showing you a whole bunch of videos, what I'd like to point out, what's important to us as a company is that these solutions enhance our what we call evolutions. And with evolutions, what we refer to are platform-based solutions that at an interesting commercial level can actually provide the solutions that our customers need while we can stick as close as possible to a standard. This is an example of one of those evolutions, which is finding the right solutions for central fulfillment for online groceries. Of course, a hot topic at the moment. And the slide you're looking at right now is one we used in customer exchange sessions that we've done and are doing currently, in which we discuss what our customers in the food segment find is the best direction to actually tackle the challenge of fulfillment in general. And this is specifically on central fulfillment. Now, what you're seeing here from left to right is, of course, the level of automation and some of our standardized solutions. Now, what was interesting for us when we were doing these exchange sessions is that in a lot of them, the little picture on the right here that says automation triggered a whole lot of questions around what's to the right of this slide. So we know a lot of your solutions as you've shown them here and appreciate them, but what's next for you guys? And that, of course, brings us to today's topic, which is robotics. And are they our friends? Now, to figure that out, as I said earlier, for us as a company, it's very important to fit that into cooperations and partnerships and relationships. Because for us, that's the quickest way to find out which of these technologies enhance and improve our solutions most. And one that I'd like to point out today is the one on the left here, the Brainport region, Eindhoven, which is also what our link is to our keynote speaker for today, Maarten. But before we switch to him, we will take a couple of minutes where I'll answer some of your questions today.
Right, we've got a lot of questions coming in here, so thanks for that. Question from Richard Flores. Thanks for your presentation, by the way. Question is, hi there, thank you for creating this webinar. What are your top three business challenges and how would you prioritize them? Your top three business challenges and how would you prioritize them?
I would start with saying that what we're seeing currently with our customers in the industry is that the flexibility of our solutions is not meeting the requirements that they have with the huge fluctuations in terms of supply chain changes.
Right. Is that particularly due to COVID?
Yeah. So
crazy times.
Crazy times. But what we also expect is that these type of disruptions are going to become a sort of new normal. So as that's, I would say, number one, we're a challenge for us is to understand what that means for our customers.
Right. That's number one.
That's number one.
Then of three.
Number two then is, of course, for us as a company, how do we actually change our solutions so that they become flexible enough to actually fit and help support the challenges of those customers.
Right.
So they're all kind of linked because the third one then is, and then with that, I'd like to bring it back to today's theme, is questions like, answering questions like, how do we take the latest and greatest in terms of technology and integrate it into the platforms that we're building right now.
Right, so companies already have existing sites and they want to integrate some systems that you have. How do you guys work it out to fit those two together in these challenging times? Yeah. So I hope that answers your question, Richard. I have another question now from Jacob. What is the, well, it's partly handled by your question just there, but anyway, let's just see if you have a different answer. Mm-hmm. What is the impact of COVID on robotics, in your view?
Ah, there's a couple of interesting answers to give there. The impact of COVID, of course, when you look at the demand side for our customers, is that well, I mentioned it earlier, the shift to online, where there's a stronger focus on bringing solutions that make it an economically viable model for our customers to actually serve those customers online as well. So that's from the demand side. When you look at the supply side, what's also very interesting is that in talking to some of our customers, what you see is that the impact of the pandemic has also been that there's a higher level of labor uncertainty.
Okay, yeah, the staff themselves,
yeah. They need additional security measures and all that that kind of stuff, which then triggers, of course, the question, what can you do with robotics to help increase the flexibility of a DC as a whole?
Great. Thanks for those questions. That's all we've got time for right now. Thank you very much for your presentation, Floris.
Thank you, Mike.
You're welcome. And now we'd like to put you, the audience, to work just for a quick second here. So we want you to answer a poll just so we can see who we've got out there and what your opinions are on robotics. So are robots your friends? You can fill it in a second. The answers are yes, they are our friends. No, they are not. Or three, I haven't decided yet. Me personally, I haven't decided yet. I don't know about you, although our next speaker, Professor Maarten, may well have the answer for us. I'm talking away because the poll is being crunched as we speak, and I believe the numbers will be coming up in a short while. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Yeah, almost there. So are robots your friends? And the answer is, as we will see right now, the answer is 68% say they are your friends, 3% are clearly not happy with robots, and 29% haven't decided yet. So can we put that as basically 2/3 are pro, 1/3 hasn't decided yet. That's a bit rough for the technically minded and mathematically minded, but let's just see. We're going to take this poll again at the end of the session to see if you change your mind. 29% haven't decided yet, so I'd like to go ahead and introduce our next guest. Thanks for filling in the poll, by the way. Professor Maarten Steinbuch. Professor Maarten Steinbuch is Distinguished University Professor at Eindhoven University of Technology, where he holds the chair of Systems and Control. He's a high-tech systems analyst, serial tech entrepreneur, and communicator. The areas covered by his research group at TU Eindhoven spans from smart and clean mobility, hot topic, mechatronics, exceedingly hot topic, robotics, that's why we're here today, and fusion plasma control. I have no idea what that is. Okay. He is most known for his work in the field of advanced motion control and mechatronics, as well as in robotics for high precision surgery, or as he referred to it in a recent meeting that we had, I build robots, he said, that drill holes in people's heads. So they have to be pretty accurate. I think you'll agree. Steinbuch is a prolific blogger and a key opinion leader on the influence of new technologies on society. And we must not forget this detail. He and his research group also work together with Vanderlande here in Veghel on a number of different projects. And today he will be providing us with some food for thought, which is relevant to that survey, by tackling the question, are robots our friends? Thank you very much for coming, Maarten. I'll leave the floor to you.
Thank you, Mike, for your kind introduction. My role is not exactly to really convince you that robots are our friends. I think as designers and engineers, we have a responsibility to make sure that robots always will be our friends, but I will come back to that later. So thank you for the opportunity to speak here on this webinar of Vanderlande. I think as a Netherlands society, we can be very proud on Vanderlande because basically Vanderlande is instrumental in for our airports and luggage, but moreover for our parcels. I propose we first look at the first video. So this was the video of Boston Dynamics. You might have seen it on the internet already. It's an amazing showcase for robotics. I think that that company makes the best and most advanced humanoid robotics. And if we think about robots, this is typically the image we sort of see. We might have buddies like humans, which are robots. You also see in this video this dog. It's in fact the first commercial product they are selling. It's rather expensive. I think it's about $80,000 you have to pay for that dog. The benefit of that dog could be that it can do surveillance, for instance, on areas for industry. So it's not for everybody, of course, but Boston Dynamics is at the forefront of technology in robotics. And the underlying message I'm going to discuss with you is the rate of development. And the rate of development all has to do with the fact that we have the law of Moore. And the law of Moore is a description, in fact, of the computational power of computers, of semiconductor industry developments. This curve has on the horizontal axis a linear time scale with the years. And on the vertical axis, it's a logarithmic scale showing the number of calculations per second per unit of dollar, so per cost. If this line would be a straight line, this means it is exponential growth because the vertical axis is a logarithmic scale. Exponential growth means doubling every fixed time period. In this case, the law of Moore typically is 18 months. Every 18 months, 1.5 year, the computational power is doubling every 18 months. And that continues and continues. And in fact, this curve shows that it goes faster, in fact, than purely exponential growth. There is a question.
Yes, there is indeed. Sorry to interrupt you flow there on Moore's law. I have a question here from Bob. He says, thanks, Bob. What do you think is the greatest barrier to the speed of adoption of robotics, I am assuming, in industry, in terms of this question? Yeah. What is the biggest barrier, in your view?
Well, there are various answers, because it largely depends on what kind of application you are looking at. Industrial robots are already used for decades in the industry, and they are also robots. I think autonomous driving, for instance, is hampered, is slowed down by safety considerations.
And those pesky human beings.
So the adoption also has to do with price, but also a little bit with the humans, in fact.
Right.
So how fast can we adopt our way of working?
Right. So it's more about the way of working than the technology, in your view, perhaps?
Both.
Right.
Technology also is not as cheap as sometimes thought.
Right.
But given this curve, it goes fast.
Right. Yeah. So we also have to change our business models as well.
Exactly. And I think this COVID time is very interesting because we are now working at home. And the question is that going to be sustainable if COVID is over, which I hope soon right. will be, and we will go to our work. But are we going to retain the good things of this period also for the future?
Yeah,
so can we really adapt our human habits?
So right. So humans plus business models are perhaps the biggest barrier. Thanks for that question. I'll let you get on, Mark.
Yes, thank you. The thing about exponential growth is that technology goes exponential and it will go on for a few decades. That's my estimation. We as humans, we tend to think linearly. So for us as humans, it's really difficult to consider what is actually the impact on our society and on us. And just to give you an example, we are very close by to Eindhoven, which has a football stadium, the PSV football stadium. It's a very big, large thing. There can be 30,000 people sitting there. Imagine at the first second, there is one raindrop falling into the stadium. At second number two, there will be two raindrops. At second number three, there will be four. So every second, the number of raindrops falling into that stadium will double every second. How long do you think will it take until the whole football stadium is filled up with water, completely filled up? How long will it take? Please type your answer in the chat and we will see some of your answers. And before that, those answers are coming, I would like to ask Mike. Mike, what do you think? Just your gut feeling.
Okay, my gut feeling says half an hour.
Okay.
I don't know, but I'm trying to work out. Oh, look, we have, great. We have some answers coming in from the audience now. So 1 minute, says Dennis. Renee says 180 seconds. Richard says 10 minutes. Hervin says 2.5 hours. Martin says 1 hour, 6 minutes. PSV Stadium filled in 15 minutes, says Joost. Stefan, 5 minutes, 32 minutes.
Thank you, Mike.
3 minutes. 2 days. Sorry, I just have to get Jean-Pierre says 2 days.
2 days. Oh, wow.
So considering, just one more. Okay. Considering the amount of rain in the Netherlands, 5 minutes. Thank you, Thiago, for that one.
That last one is great. Yeah. The answer is, people, 47 seconds. 47 seconds. And at second number 46, the stadium is half filled. Minus one drop. This is exponential growth. Amazing, eh? And this is how technology changes. So if you have your smartphone now, it is amazing how it developed over the last years, but the development will not be like the last years. It will be twice as fast as the last years. So if you compare your smartphone with the version you had 5 years ago, that change will be the same the next 2.5 years. And then 1.25 years, and then less than a year. This is exponential thinking. And I have to admit that in the COVID time, we all are also noticing exponential growth, like the R number. And I don't know the definition if it's per day or per week. Let's take per week. If the R is 1.3, it means that every week there will be 30% more people who can infect others. That's also exponential growth. It's 1.3 times, 1.3 times, 1.3, etc. That's why it's so important to get this R number below 1, because otherwise we will have exponential growth of the number of COVID cases. So exponential rate of change. And this is exactly what is pushing technology changes. I'm going to the next slide now. So this means that sensors and computational power will develop at an exponential rate. Actuators a little bit less. So that means that all our society will move from the left to the right. So from physics, from touchable things, from stones in a house to smart houses, from mechanical engineering cars to smart cars. Everything will move to the right. The same for robotics and the place of robotics in suitcases or package handling for Vanderlande. And it has also impact on the human. I will go to the next slide and you'll see a nice video now.
Proberen me waar te maken. Van der Tantwil. Van der Tantwil gaat proberen Robodinho aan te spelen. Robodinho biedt zich aan. Zong Yi opletten. Zong Yi let helemaal niet op. Wat zeg ik? Robodinho aan de bal. En dan gaan ze proberen hier weer in de aanval. En dan is het, ja, heel goed. En nou draaien. Open doel. Robodinho. Oh, Van der Tantwil. Van der Tantwil. Van der Tantwil probeert 2-3 man verdediging langs. 1 man, 2 man kwijt. Nu nog eentje. Van der Tantwil. Van der Tantwil. Ja! 2-2! Met nog maar 5 seconden op de klok. 2-2!
Yeah, what you did see was a video of the world champion soccer in 2013 with our team, Tech United, with our robots. Here you see a picture of those robots. Basically, they are completely autonomous. So we are just standing at the side of the playing field and just watching and hoping that they do it right. You did see now the last 2 minutes of the game, the final game. Against the Chinese team, and we were behind with 1-2, and we scored the 2-2 just before the end of the second half. And so we were so happy. The interesting thing is what you could see in this video are, in fact, not the robots, but the 5,000 people in the audience, grandparents, parents, children. I was also in the audience, and we were so focused and so emotional looking to a bunch of robots. That was amazing, and that was a thing I thought, hey, we as humans, we in fact can connect to robots. A very interesting observation.
Sorry to interrupt you again, Maarten, but we have a question from the audience straight away. Do you know, Maarten, of an epic story where a robotic solution did fail to solve the target problem? So do you know about, this is from Mehdi, thanks Mehdi, a story where a robotic solution failed to answer the question it was given?
It is like any technology, that if you start with technology, there are glitches. So in a startup phase of implementing robotics, you have to retune and tune and retune. And sometimes it's not worrisome. So like, for instance, if you install an industrial robot, or here at Vanderlande a pick and place robot, it could be that you have to tune that robot, that you have to teach it, right? Or to teach it to do some learning. And there are, of course, a lot of developments with artificial intelligence to let the learning being done by the robot. But normally there might also be hardware failures, and then you have to repair and reiterate, and that's normal.
But we're talking about an epic failure, falling out of the sky.
I'm going to that. So something. I think an answer is there, that there was a lot of hope focused on autonomous driving.
And the cars.
The Uber car, the Volvo, killed a female in the dark who passed, went over the road.
Right.
And that stopped a few years ago, all developments for a certain time, because we don't accept as humans that technology fails.
Right, right.
And we accept that as a humanity, we have every day
humans failing.
We have about 3,000 deaths in traffic every day worldwide, 3,000 a day.
Yeah.
We don't talk about that. But if there is one person killed by technology, we talk about it, which is a good thing, because we have to improve technology.
Okay, so I think that answers your question, Mehdi. Yeah. We're going to crack on now.
Yeah, thank you. So I already mentioned the AI, and also the AI role for soccer. And we had a student who was working on this. You can see that here. The video shows a master student.
So that guy is the student himself?
Yes.
He's putting his life on the line.
What you see here is that this student worked on optimizing the shooting algorithm of the robot. And after some time tuning of the AI algorithms, the robot becomes so good that he dared to sit there in the goal and have a tennis ball on his head and have the pointing mechanism of the robot perfect. You can see that here. Yeah. So let's move to the next one. This is the power of AI. So what we of course also do, and you can see it in the next movie, is that we apply our knowledge, which we gained with the soccer playing game, we apply that to societal relevant cases. Like in this case, we developed a platform to have an hospital bed being driven autonomously. And you can see here that this bed is basically driving autonomously. It can rotate, it can move sideways. And this can also be an answer to the increasing shortage of people in hospitals. And it can, of course, not only be useful for beds, but also for decontamination robots during the night, or for the linen, the bed sheets motions in a hospital.
We have another question. I'm going to
And then we move back to the, you can stop the video. Yeah.
Okay, Torge, I hope I've said that correctly, asks, when you use so much sensoric technology and a kind of brute force learning, how can you tell what the results should be? Because you said that we humans think in a linear way.
Yeah.
Good question.
Yeah. So I think that the technical systems we design as humans, we always design them within certain limits of operation. So with this booming of sensory information, Internet of Things and so on, we always still have to do with designed technical systems, which are designed by humans. And we design basically the
parameters.
Yeah, the parameters and also the area in which that technology should operate.
Right. I think that's a good question for this. This is an add-on question here from Joost. He says, how is safety for humans arranged in this bed environment, which you've just seen with the hospital? Yeah, how do you keep it safe?
Very nice question. So safety is the first specification if you go to such applications. And we have a lot of sensor technology in those motors. And also you can design control algorithms such that if there is an opposite force, so if a human is walking there, that you sense that the motor can never give too much force so that you endanger safety.
Yeah. Right, so safety is the first consideration,
yeah, exactly,
is the answer.
Exactly.
I'll let you carry on.
So this picture might also be known by you. You have seen this before. And this is a different type of robotics. It's not soccer playing robots, not industrial robots, not pick and place. This is robot technology for people. And if you look to this picture, it is the Paro seal from Japan. It is really cozy and nice if you see it. What do you think if you see this picture? Are you happy or are you sad? Well, most people have two emotions. And on the one hand, you are happy for this lady who's a client with dementia, and she is happy with that toy, with that stuffed animal, with the knuffel in Dutch. It could also give a sad emotion because you think, hey, there should be a person instead of a robot. Now, robots can be very close to us, and for that reason, I also took my own playmate with me, so to speak. And that robot is, it's called Pleo. It's sort of like a Tamagotchi, you could say. If you buy it, it is sleeping a lot. But after some time, it is going to be more active. It's full of sensors. So if I touch it, it's going to react. In a minute, it will, but now it's waking up. It's very nice. It's about $400 or so. You can buy it via internet. It's from Korea originally. And I will just take it here. And you can see it also. It's very nice. The bigger question you could ask yourself is, suppose that the computer chip inside this robot is developing with an exponential rate. So the next generation of this Pleo Dino is much smarter than now. And maybe in 10 years from now, it is as smart as me. Or in 20 years from now, yeah. What can it actually mean? And now and then I also give lectures for children. And a few years ago, a child asked me, hey, can a robot ever fall in love with me? And I said, well, a robot can tempt to fall in love with you. And you can certainly fall in love with a robot, but a robot does not feel anything. The question I'm asking myself is, will that ever be the answer? I will turn it off now, because otherwise the robot will keep, I just take off the battery, yeah? So simple. Only you will only look to the robot. I had the opportunity to think about this question with the Dalai Lama. I met the Dalai Lama 2 years ago when he was in the Netherlands for an opening of a Buddha exhibition. And I asked the Dalai Lama, suppose that exponential technology will lead to computers in 30 years from now, which is only one generation, in 30 years from now, which are far more smarter than humans. Can a robot like this robot ever have consciousness? That was my question to the Dalai Lama. And I gave the robot to the Dalai Lama and had a very interesting discussion about 15 minutes with the Dalai Lama. And his answer was the following. Our consciousness, our human consciousness, is about 7 layers. The most physical layer is our sensory information, which you can rebuild that with computers. The second layer is our dreams during the night. And he said that's still physical. So it's still chemistry in your head. You can rebuild that with computers. But the deepest of the 7 layers is the human spirit. It makes what you makes you. It's your soul, so to speak. And he said that is something which is not material. Now, if you think deeper about this, it means the following reasoning. If you assume that your deepest layer, what makes you you, what makes me me, is indeed something which is spiritual, we will never be able to do that with computers. However, if you assume that what makes me me, what makes you you as a person, is chemistry in your brains, if you assume that, there will be a time with this exponential growth of technology that we can make computer systems, robots, which also have a consciousness. And if we take this as a thought for the future, say 30 years from now, it means that when our children have our age, so one generation, 30 years, we might live in a different kind of society. That's a deep thought, I think.
I have a question. That's a hugely deep thought. My mind has just exploded in the studio. I'm afraid that's an extremely philosophical thing. We have a question coming here from Koskun. A question just popped up while he was talking about sensors. So we're going slightly backtracking here on the huge subject you just broached. And it says, which and for what purpose are sensors going to be implemented to robots in the future? So what do you see as future applications for sensors?
Okay, so my true profession is feedback, control mechanisms. And we know that sensors are key. To measure is to know. That's the phrase you should take home.
I think
also.
That's meten is weten in Dutch.
Meten is weten, yeah. So to measure is to know. If you wrongly measure, you cannot act correctly.
Right, so it's empirical measurement.
The interesting thing is, if you act incorrectly, but you measure correctly, you can correct it. If you measure incorrectly, you can never correct.
Right, so it's all about the measurement.
It's all about the measurement. So the more measurements you have, the more you can actually do.
But can you imagine a new application for sensors? I think they're like something we haven't thought about.
That depends on the field. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are more and more, for instance, people looking to sensors in your clothing.
Right.
If you walk, that sensors track how you have motion, and then they give you feedback how to move better or whatever. Of course, we all know the watches and whatever.
Yeah.
But there's a whole bunch of things. Sensors will be everywhere, in cars, in houses, in everything.
So measurement is key. Yeah. Meten is weten.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, we have another question. Yeah. From Alex. Thanks, Alex. How far will robots be able to add to our brain live in the future? So this is when you've got that chip in your head.
Yeah,
how
nice.
Are they going to help
so if
me?
If you think about my block diagram with physics and sensors and cyberspace or computers, if you think about the human, you could also augment humans with technology. For instance, a pacemaker is a very simple device. It is measuring and actuating. A hearing device is the same. So the next level could be your brains. And Elon Musk just was in the news. He's hiring a lot of people for Neuralink. Neuralink is a company he started. His goal, and he just said yesterday, that he expects in 2 years from now, there will be the first implementations of chips in brains of people. And there are many good applications. For instance, there are already startups, I know, thinking about implementing a brain for people who are blind.
Right.
And with the chip, they can start to see again.
He was talking about robotics there. So is a chip a robot in your view?
No. A chip is a computational device.
Right.
For me, a robot should also have some physics with things.
We have another question, a quick one, sure, from Vlada. Robots are smarter than humans when they have no feelings to suffer as a human. So they are our future. So are they our future, I suppose?
Yeah.
Are they our future if they're smarter than humans and they have no emotions? So they're better than us.
Yeah. In some sense, computers are already better than us. I mean, my smartphone can do things I cannot do.
Right.
And again, I think the most important thing is what I told about if a robot in the future can have a consciousness, you could also think, hey, are they going to take us over?
Mm.
And I think we are in charge of designing those systems, and we can always design them such that they have their limit of
but operation. If we want to, you never know who's going to be designing them.
That is true. So it's
some societies are slightly less, shall we say, morally encumbered by
and
this
that's
idea.
Also, of course, the discussions in United Nations about, for instance, drones for areas of combat, of war. To what extent can the drones themselves decide certain things? Or should there be a human in the loop?
Okay, we've got to go now. There's more questions, thanks, but we've got to hurry up.
Okay. So having this big vision about robots in the future, I mean, we are close to the end, but still I want to give you some food for thought. Suppose in the future I have a pill. And if you take that pill, you can speak a new language. You can choose your own language. The pill is for free, the drug is for free, and everybody can have it. Would you like to take that pill? And you can give your answers in the chat. So say yes or no. The first pill is for being able to speak a new language. The second pill, if you take that pill, you stay healthy. So who would like to take that pill? You can say yes or no in the chat. And if you think here, maybe...
Yeah, let's have a look.
Just briefly, yes or no?
Yeah, I think there's more yeses. Yes, more yeses and definitely than no's.
Not
very many no's.
Yeah. Now I have my third pill. If you take that pill, you will have eternal life. You will live forever. Would you like to take that pill?
The answers are coming in as we speak. Stay healthy, yes. No. No way. No. No. So people are not...
Interesting, eh?
Yeah, people are don't want to live forever.
You should know there are already companies who are focusing on longevity. So to design systems such that we can live forever. Their focus is first 120 years, then 150 years by analyzing our DNA and having good drugs and food. Interesting, eh? I have a fourth pill. If you take that pill, you die. If you are now sure that we have the fourth pill for you, would you now take the third pill?
Okay, quickly, fair answer for that. If you could have the pill, so you can switch yourself on and off, basically. You can live forever, and then you think, I've had enough, I'll take pill number four.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't get them mixed up. Yes, I would say that most people are now saying, yes, they would take the third
Interesting,
pill.
Interesting. So all of us sort of like to experiment a little bit, right? And that is the...
But we want to be able to switch ourselves off if necessary.
Think about this pill, this drug question, because it is very... And I don't exclude that in 30 years from now, this is not science fiction. This might be true. I'm not sure. This might be true. Think about this with your family and partners. It's a nice question. I have to go now to my the next few slides of my presentation. So having talked about robotics, you should know that we are all here in the high-tech region of Eindhoven, and we are very proud on our high-tech industry like Vanderlande and ASML and Philips and you name them. And I started also to work on surgical robotics, because this is also robotics where a human is still in the loop. We call it master-slave. And this is just an example of one of the spin-outs of our group. This is focused on microsurgery, and you can see in the movie that the surgeon is actually being helped by robotics by making the accuracy of his hands tenfold better than without robot. And now here you can see that he's moving, and because we can scale down his motion and we can filter the tremor he might have or she, we can actually have much better operations. And this machine is, for instance, used to connect veins, blood vessels or lymph vessels to with a very small diameter. You can see here the moving instruments. Given the time, I propose that we go on, so we can switch back to the next slide. Yeah, so we go to the next slide now, I hope. Yes, let's go to the next one, because this one you already saw with Floris's talk, and this one also. This is Vanderlande, also utilizing sensor technology and cheaper sensor technology. This is a nice animation of a PhD student who is actually an employee of Vanderlande. You can start the video, please. This is a video of an optimization PhD program of somebody of Vanderlande who is in my group. We also have an assistant professor from Vanderlande, an employee of Vanderlande who works in our group to make models. And you can see here the autonomous carts driving in a warehouse. And this is exactly where mathematics and optimization is going to be used, how to optimize the topology and the routing of those automated guided vehicles. And it's very close in fact to the things we learn with our soccer playing robots. So let's move forward to the next slide. And of course, you all can read about developments in cars. And I propose, given the time, that we skip this one. It's a very nice video of an autonomous learning car from a student team from Zurich. You can look at it on the internet. This is a display of a commercial available car in the US, which is not only using lane keeping on highways, but actually really doing autonomous driving in city environments. It's not yet here in Europe. It's not yet fully shown in the US, but still there are already commercial cars doing this. The key message I want to give to you is that technology is developing with an exponential rate. It is doubling every 18 months, and it will change our society. And that also means that we have to think about how can we, say, change our organizations. I personally, I'm working at Eindhoven, University of Technology, and I think that universities also can take a different thinking and a different way of working. And that's why we started the Eindhoven Engine, where we try to collaborate with companies and knowledge institutes in order to facilitate the exponential rate of innovation. So we accelerate innovation by bringing people really together in co-locations. And I think that working together can be much helped by being actually co-located in one facility. And in the Brainport region, we actually know quite well how to cooperate. So to accelerate innovation is the message of the Eindhoven Engine, and that's what we are currently pushing. So this is the end of my talk. I hope you liked to have the discussion. And there is time for one last question.
Yes, indeed. Fascinating. Yes. Thank you very much, Maarten. I think we covered a huge amount of ground there. Obviously, a helicopter view there from consciousness to warehousing robotics. I have one more question from Carol. When do we see robots picking cases in, this is specifically a warehousing question, when do we see robots picking cases in manual warehouses instead of humans? Technology mature and pricing competitive. Okay, it's a specific question. But when do we see them in manual warehouses instead of humans?
Yeah. It's the same question as when do we expect robotics to help elderly people who live at home, right? It's a similar question. You need a similar type of robot, a robot which can act autonomously. I think in 10 years from now, max. Not within the next 5 years. Why? Because it's still very expensive. I think those robots I showed at the start of Boston Dynamics, those humanoid robots, I think if they make them, say, 100,000 a year, it will still cost a fortune, like 120,000 euros. There is no business case yet to put a 120,000 euro robot in a household to help an elderly person. However, if you reduce the task, then there can be robots which are much more cheap.
But they're smaller systems, cheaper systems.
And more focused on one task, like the vacuum cleaner. You can buy it for 150 euros.
Yeah.
But it can only clean your floor. That's it.
Right. Thanks very much for that question. I'm afraid we have to wind it up now. So thank you very much, Professor Maarten Steinbuch and Floris Scheer, for coming along and presenting today. I'd just like to round off the webinar here. Thank you very much for watching. We want to check if your opinion has changed during the process of this webinar. So again, are robots our friends? Yes, they are. Are robots our friends? No, they are not. Or, see, I haven't decided yet. I personally still haven't decided yet, but I'm not very good at making proper decisions, as people in my house will tell me. However, this robot is my friend. So in that sense, I'm torn between two specific standpoints on this. I think I'd like one to vacuum my house, but do I want one to replace humans in my life? I don't know. Here we go. We're in 69%, yes. 6% no, oh dear, 3% more do not find robots their friends, and 25% haven't decided yet. So 25% is roughly the same, but unfortunately we've seen an increase in people who say that robots are not our friends. But thanks very much for that. At least we've been thinking about it during this fascinating presentation. I'd like to draw your attention to the forthcoming editions of Vanderlande Connects. So this has been the first edition. We're live and direct here in Fechel. There's some more editions coming up, which I'd just like to run through you with, because they've got fascinating topics, more specifically directed towards warehousing solutions. Where do you register? First of all, you go to vanderlande.com/events. And the next one we've got coming up in March is on food retail, which is about ensuring on time and in full grocery store deliveries in a volatile market environment. Well, we've had a volatile market environment right recently, I think you'll agree. We've got fashion, general merchandise and e-commerce is the following edition. That's about smart entry logistics using a pocket system in e-commerce and omnichannel warehouses. Again, a specific solution with the particularly interesting answers, I think you'll find. The next edition is about food e-commerce, overcoming the fulfillment challenges of online groceries. Now, online groceries has exploded in the recent past. So this is a specific one for those people who are dealing with those particular problems. And a final one is about managing unpredictable growth in e-commerce. So supply, demand, how do you deal with the variants that we've been seeing? So please go to vanderlande.com/events and register for the forthcoming editions of Vanderlande Connects. This has been the first edition. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you very much to our speakers. And thank you very much to the technical team who's made this all possible here in Fechel. See you next time on Vanderlande Connects. And remember, let's connect.